and proudly announce to the world that you can now pay real, actual money for a computer with basically the same guts as an iPad.
Linus, what's up, dude? So check this out. This is a fairly capable machine. It's not a 3090 or a Ryzen system, but it's not bad. 10 cores, got a beefy GPU, and what I have here is Sony FX9 HDR 10-bit footage. It's about 19 seconds long. What I'm gonna do is, while I do this video, I'm going to bounce this as a 10-bit H.265 HDR file. We're gonna start that. I'm gonna throw this open. We're gonna see a couple things, right? We're gonna see the CPU cores just spike up and you should start hearing the fans. Now, in the meantime, while this thing is chugging along, I have the iPhone 12 mini, little guy. Keep in mind, this thing is still slowly chugging along. I'm gonna open up iMovie. I'll even start a new file. Don't worry if I screw up because that thing is taking a while. So projects, new, movie. I'm going to take that same file, 10-bit HDR, create a movie. The first thing you notice is just the scrubbing in the playback, right? So this is a fanless, teeny tiny iPhone 12 and just butter. So what I'm going to do is take that, export, make sure we're in 4K on 20% battery, HDR. Keep in mind, this thing is still going. It's got a nice little head start, right? So this is on a battery, about 20% left, no fan, and this is a decked out iMac. So that's all I'm saying, man, is don't jump the gun. Real time, that ended up being about 2+ minutes on the iMac for a 20-second clip and seconds on the mini. And for the King Stefans out there who think that it was some sort of quality degradation or that the iPhone bounced into H.264, nope. Same file, 10-bit H.265, HLG, HDR. Thank you, next. First off, Linus, you know I love you. And for those watching, I truly, truly do. He's an incredible human, great dad, hardworking. That beard, though, I just feel like the take on Apple's new M1 system was a little premature. Granted, within his video, which if you missed, I'll drop a link to down below, there are very fair and valid skepticisms. I get it, this is a new platform for Apple. Not everything's gonna be perfect. Not every app is going to be optimized out of the gate. There's a new operating system with Big Sur, but the problem is you don't get any of that sentiment until the latter part of the video. And after ad pitch A and merch pitch B, most people are gonna tune out by then and really just hold on to the sentiment right smack at the beginning.
I mean, remember how people thought the iPad was gonna be a portable touchscreen MacBook? Turns out it was opposite day. But now that opposite day has arrived, if I'm an Apple user looking for a new Mac, do I want the iPad with no touchscreen, the iPad with no screen, or the iPad with a touch bar?
That's the part that's a little bit misleading, and I get it. People want to see the numbers, the data, the gigahertz. They want to see actual metrics as opposed to ambiguous charts and curves. And for those people who really want to dive into that stuff and talk about the cores and the cache and die, there's a really good article from Anantech that I'll link to down below.
Future editing, John here. Apparently, allegedly, there was a leak that happened right now that puts the baseline MacBook Air, in terms of Geekbench, ahead of a 16-inch MacBook Pro.
Now, bet, there's gonna be a couple comments that I know I'm going to see over and over. One will pertain to that clip I showed at the beginning. That's gonna be, okay, that's impressive, but what if I don't use Final Cut? What if I use Premiere? What if I use Resolve? What if I don't edit video at all? What if I do music? What if I just want to edit notes or code? Where's the benefit for me? Why did I have the bowl, Bart? Why did I have the bowl? And to that I would say, for those who aren't doing video or crunching heavy tasks, they're probably going to appreciate the near 20-hour battery life. Like, that is an actual tangible benefit.
20 hours of video playback is bonkers. Like, that's a solid 50% more for the same battery size as the previous generation. It's as if it's new battery tech. Right, and imagine there's some new carbon-based battery that you know, imagine that came out. Hey, here's some new batteries that are 50% better than what you had before. That's what it feels like. This is how significant it is. And when I look into the comments and people are complaining about, oh, the bezels are the same. They didn't change the hard, like, who cares? 50% better battery life. Do you get that?
The other thing that is just kind of over people's heads is that it's not just about these machines being faster. 2X, 3X, that's all cool. It's that they're faster with lower power consumption. Definitely have to test this out, but it's looking like that new Mac Mini is going to draw significantly less power than prior models. Right, so that kind of power draw, or in this case, lack thereof, is bananas to the point where you know somebody, probably me, is going to rig this Mac Mini up to a portable battery bank of some kind. Let's play a little hypothetical game for a second. Imagine a week or two ago, you were looking to buy a 13-inch MacBook Pro. All of a sudden, this new one comes out, and let's put M1 optimized applications aside because we know there's going to be a huge benefit there. For older applications that aren't optimized, even if you're getting the same or slightly better performance through Rosetta, why would you not go for that? Because in 6 months, when that update drops for something like Photoshop, it's going to get better automatically. We really gotta look at things through a different perspective and lens, and especially on the PC master race side of things. No offense, everyone is looking at this archaically. Everyone is programmed to look at things at gigahertz and CPU cores and GPU cores, right? That's an argument that I saw. Well, that's not really fair because the iPhone is accelerated where it's not truly using just the CPU. And I'm like, that's the point. People also wanna hop in and comic book guy me and say, well, that's not that impressive. Acceleration has been here for years. And I'm just like, cool, if it's been there, why hasn't Intel done it well yet? Things like video encoding and decoding is why you can drop 10-bit Sony A7S3 footage on a fanless iPad Air, walk around like you're holding a pancake, and it runs like butter, dog. You then have things like a 16-core neural engine, which is gonna be a game changer for AI and machine learning. I can already see potential benefits in applications like Pixelmator or Photoshop. Things that require AI or quick machine learning is going to be huge. As far as the whole MacBook Air, MacBook Pro, Mac Mini debate, it's not as complex as some people are making it out to be. The MacBook Air has no fan, so it's gonna be silent, and you're going to get less performance over sustained loads, whereas the MacBook Pro with a cooling system, that's gonna be better for longer, more intense applications. One thing people are also missing on the whole MacBook Air versus MacBook Pro, aside from the whole touch bar thing, the MacBook Pro has a brighter screen at 500 nits versus 400, so if you do photo editing or video editing, you might appreciate that extra brightness. Then you have the Mac Mini, which essentially is the power of a 13-inch MacBook Pro. You just subtract the touch bar and the display and you can bring your own. I've been tweeting some of my favorite monitors to pair with the Mac Mini just in case you're looking at picking one up, so I'll drop those in the description. Aside from that though, thank you guys so much for watching. Hopefully you enjoyed this. And all I'm gonna say is just don't write things off until you try them.